there's two parts of one, but one of the folding program, that's another discussion. But the key of what they're bringing before us is how do you increase relevance, rigor, relationships? Those are the three kingpins for a successful program in any education setting. In particular, it's on steroids in an alternative ed setting. So they're asking for that opportunity. How do we engage in the depth that is involved with project-based learning, which is significant in terms of equipping them with skills to be successful post-secondary? I respectfully disagree with you. I think a diploma is exceedingly important for them. So that's one problem before. But the other is, are we preparing them with those skills via something like project-based learning, which takes more time cross-curricular to make that happen? I think that's really what we're looking for.
I think that once it gets widely known that the requirements to graduate from a FUSIA are becoming less and less and less, the stigma of graduating from a FUSIA is going to become more and more and more. We don't want these children to be known for having just skated through a program that continually is only asking of them a less rigorous environment.
I think we have to kind of keep in mind the word alternative. Independent study schools, online schools, we can't compare that to our classrooms either. So it's another alternative to an opportunity for education. These are students that are at-risk students to begin with. And we're trying to make sure we do give them those skills to go, the English, the math, and so forth. And it isn't walk in, it isn't that box. English class, English 4, we're going to get this. It's kids at many different points of where they're at. So when you're in a classroom, when you're with 5 or 20, and all I know there's 20 kids in a classroom, that sounds pretty good. Yeah, 20 kids. Whereas at Refugio, with 20 kids, many of them are at different points. So the teacher wants to be able to give them the quality that they need there. It's not just, here's a lecture, we're all doing on the same topic, you know, open your book kind of thing. And it's complicated for, I think, if someone hasn't been in there, it's complicated to describe. So the extra rigor, you know, the extra electives, and I think that just kind of looking at, there's a reason why other schools have a similar number that we're talking about. We're still above the state requirement for credits, even if we go to 210. So, you know, we believe in trying to educate them, and it's not skate through, because these kids, they've got to come. I mean, a lot of them have missed school, a lot of them have home issues, so getting them there is a real plus, and having them be challenged in English and challenged in math and all these things is a big plus, and that's what we really feel like this will give those kids that opportunity.
You and I look at this chart a little differently. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 alternative schools listed where they give the total graduation requirement. At the top of the heap is Refugio requiring 230. And then it goes down from there, and when you look at that chart, you're inclined to say, well, you know, that gives us justification for we can lower our requirements and still be in the game.
Can these kids still take the classes, the elective classes, if they want?
In the afternoon.
I wanted to finish my comment. When I look at this chart, to me, this is a badge of honor. Refugio has set itself above the crowd. We've elevated our minimum standards over the other six. And now what we're saying is we don't need to be above the crowd anymore. We can start bringing ourselves down with the also fans.
But so, when you're at the last few weeks of school, we almost had 6 graduates that did graduate this year, like not graduate. It was that close. And John and I had come up with creative plans. And I would say, 4 out of the 6 were electives. And that's where we were scrambling this year just to get these kids to graduate. In the end, all 9 did end up graduating, but that was the hiccup, that we had to come with creative ways because, you know, we just don't have the resources.
Well, is that fair to the students? If they don't have the minimum to graduate, then should we just be forcing them and finding a way to make sure they graduate?
I think one of the things to look at, too, when you see full day here, not all their kids are going full day. So it's not here's an 8-2-3 kind of thing. So we see full day, it's offered full day, but they're not all going full day. That's one thing I think we need to kind of look at in terms of carrying apples to apples. In terms of finding ways, our teachers on San Ynez High School, they're working with the students. How can we find a way? Here's that extra credit. You missed this over here. You got to go. Whether kids up until that end. If we just left it up to all the kids, some would do just great and a lot wouldn't. And so we're here, I mean, my job as a guidance counselor is, you know, very diverse. And working with AP kids and working with the other ones, but we're always looking at ways to help the kids. Some of them are to help themselves. Okay, here's your information, you go do it if you don't. But these kids are really, it's a different structure, and they're walking in deficient in credits. So we can't treat it the same way as the student who is on track. They are deficient, and so it takes a lot more moving parts to get them there. And that's our goal. It was wonderful this year that that many kids made it, because there was just time during this year, I don't think either one of us thought it would get there. They were coming to school, right, they were counting it, and I mean, kids are sweating bullets, and it's not always fun, but it was great to see that many kids make it. I was really happy.
I would often have students come to my senior English class who had a bit of improvement in high school. That was not uncommon. Second semester, these would come in. And I think what they're saying is absolutely accurate. Most of the time, the kids who go out there, for whatever personal reasons they have, but there are holes in their education. I've been really heartened after your last presentation, the idea that you're going to be going into greater depth and heightening what they're doing in the four course. I mean, that's exceptionally important, it seems to me. And I think oftentimes, not always certainly, but some of the time, some elective classes can be seen as kind of blow-off classes where they screw around and, you know, do this or do that. And I really like the emphasis upon academics for them, because I think that's what they need to be moving forward. Not that the other isn't great for them, but the focus should be on the academics.
If there's some screw around in elective classes, then that is an indictment on us.
Well, that's not what I'm saying right now. I'm talking about kids. They're forced to be in an academic setting. They're encouraged to go deep and to connect things and do project learning. That's the way to go, it seems to me. If I were a parent and a student, I would be very heartened by the emphasis that you're making here.
Well, I appreciate what you're doing, and don't interpret my firm questions as lack of school.
No, it's a school.
Thank you.
So, thanks both for being here, and I would, just for the board reflection, more credits does not necessarily mean more quality. And so I think what we're after is how do we get depth in the places that our students need it to be successful post-secondary. That's what we're trying to achieve.
Thank you so much.
Thank you both for being here. We'll connect soon.
Okay, item two. San Ynez Valley Community Aquatics Foundation, Aquatics Complex Proposition 68 funding.
So, some familiar faces.
And
we'd like to introduce all three for those that don't know them. Kyle Bell, Lisa Palmer, and Kristen Thompson. Thank you so much for being here. The purpose of this evening is to give you an information brief about State Proposition 68 that could make a significant impact on the rate amount needed to make the aquatics complex a reality. And tonight we'll be back on our June 25 board meeting agenda for a full discussion. We want to make sure you have plenty of opportunities to ask your questions in advance. That's why we have the three of you here. So thank you again for that time, and again for waiting.
Well, thank you, Superintendent Corey.
Thank
you for being here members. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. If you may recall from the May 14th presentation that was done here to your board, we talked about the Prop 68 funds being a major strategic opportunity for us in our fundraising effort. And those funds come from a bond measure that was approved last June by the voters, $4 billion total in parks, water, and environment. And so the proposed aquatics complex qualifies for those funds as a new facility. And so what I wanted to introduce to you today is the concept of how we can maximize, the foundation and the community standpoint, can maximize our probability of being successful in obtaining $6.3 million of those funds. This coming cycle is the first round of funds, the most round of funds available. So it's a huge opportunity for us if we are successful in district to conceptually agree to a joint use lease agreement with the city of Milton. That's the headline. We'll get into the details of why we arrived at that solution in just a minute. It's very similar. One of the reasons we think it's the best solution and works for the community is it's very similar to the existing agreement between the Milton Union School District and the city of Milton. It enables them to offer the parks and rec, the successful park and rec services they provide in their community. So that is the model we're looking at. And again, what we'll be asking of you when we come back in a couple weeks, when the item comes back for consideration in a couple weeks, is a conceptual approval of entering into an agreement. That's all we need to move forward with the grant, is conceptual agreement on your part that if we were successful in being granted those funds, that the district would then need to move forward with negotiating and entering into that joint lease agreement. So with that, just to tee it up, I'm going to turn it over to Kyle Pavello. He's the Milton Rec Supervisor, and he's going to walk you through a little bit more of how that agreement could work based on his experience. Take it away.
Thank you, Lisa.
That's right, the microphone isn't even on. It just
it's just
there's
a
button there, a red button, press and hold for 2 seconds.
There we go.
So sorry. Much more effective on.
Yes, I did. Yeah.
See, when Laura's not here, all these details
are important.
So, Madam President, honorable board members, and community members and staff, thank you for allowing us to be here tonight. As Lisa said, the City of Milton and the Milton Union School District have a joint use agreement that has been in place for more than 10 years. President Clevenger is very well acquainted with this agreement, as she was the principal at Honda School when this was beginning to take place. The school district, Milton Union School District, approached the city when the state had a program for joint use gymnasiums. And with the city putting in funds, the district putting in funds, and a matching grant from the state, they were able to build the rec center gymnasium on the corner there at Honda Middle School. Before that, Honda did not have a place where they could even hold graduation because the old multi-purpose room was too small for that. They had to use the Marriott Hotel. With that agreement between the school district and the city, they were able to build that facility as well as refurbish some of the adjoining kindergarten classrooms that were no longer occupied with Oak Valley Elementary being built. And the district owns that property. It's still district property, but the operations are handled by the city rec department. Scheduling, programming for the community. But the important thing to note is that the school district has the priority use. Any sports, any activities, assemblies, graduation, obviously take first priority. It is their facility. The other times when they are not using the facility is when the rec department is able to program those for the general public and the community to have that benefit. It's worked very well. The two entities renewed that agreement for another 20 years because it has worked so well. It's the idea of the whole joint use in the beginning is to have different entities, instead of building facilities that are used half the time, really to maximize the use and the community benefit for those. And so I think it is done exactly as it was intended. Successful local collaboration was what drew the eye of the Aquatics Foundation to approach both the high school district and the city to look at some similar agreement, in this case, to be eligible for these Prop 68 grant application. High school districts aren't eligible because they are eligible for other state Prop 51 funds, and so this is a different pool of bond funding that is only for local governments such as cities. And so that is where this joint use agreement comes into being. It would allow the foundation and this project to be eligible for up to $6.3 million in those state grant funds. So just as with the current agreement that Milton has with Milton Union District, if the district and the city agree to move forward in that conceptual phase, The same protections would be in place for the district to have prior use of the facility. And again, the rec department would just be doing scheduling and community programming in other times when it was not being used by the school. I have done some more research in particular on joint use agreements for aquatics facilities, both with our Buellton City Attorney and the city's insurer, which is the California Joint Powers Insurance Authority. And they have indicated there are many examples throughout the state of a successful joint use agreements on aquatics facilities. Our city's attorney and insurer actually have a lot of experience working with the school district's insurer, CISC, on these agreements, because all those other districts that have these joint use agreements are all insured by CISC as well. So there's a good track record of this type of agreement. They would, before, if we are granted these funds, there would be a long period of negotiation between the district's council, their insurer, the city's insurer, to make sure that all parties are protected. So without taking any more time, I just wanted to again reiterate that we will be coming back at the June 25th board meeting for a full discussion, where we'll be asking you to conceptually consider approval of that idea. The Buellton City Council will be considering this proposal at their meeting this Thursday on the 13th. So at this point, if there are any questions from board members or staff, we would be happy to answer them if we can.
Chris, I guess I would ask how is wrap up how this has changed from where we were headed before.
I'll let that be answered here by Lisa. The previous trajectory, I guess.
Okay. If you mean before, since May, or before 2 years ago.
We've been working.
Right. I think, well, you know, part of it is the opportunity to be able to get, to qualify for that kind of bond money. It's a huge opportunity for this valley to be able to bring in a $6 million chunk of money in one fell swoop is rare. And so we've looked at how can we best accomplish that. So, and the other part, frankly, is looking at all monies available, not just grants, not just private donors. If that money is out there and available and we qualify, we should be doing what we can to obtain it. You know, initially, we thought, well, the county, right, would be a good lead agent on this. We're in an unincorporated area. But the short answer to that is, they do parks, they don't do rec. From a logistical and a liability standpoint, it was clear that wasn't going to be viable. And at the end of the day, frankly, I think a local control and having a community that has a track record of a similar and like agreement.
I'm not trying to interrupt you.
No.
Accidentally.
Oh, okay. Where they have, we have a tried and true model that's been successful in our backyard. And the city of Buellton has, I don't say skin in the game, in seeing a community valley-wide facility realized, you know, and land that we have available with an operation and maintenance opportunity from the district side. We have a programming, people with programming experience and track record who would be able to provide the programming expertise all within our valley. So Chris, or Mrs. Burtness, I don't know if that answers your question. It was one of those things that we've been looking at other public monies, and when that came on our radar, we wanted to figure out how we might be able to make it work. And, you know, kudos to Kristen and also Kyle wearing his district and the city of Buellton and Parks and Rec advocate and, you know, Valley youth and health and wellness advocacy hat. We've had a pretty good working group that's helped us figure out how to navigate this. And that being said, too, we are meeting with Supervisor Harvey's office again tomorrow. Let them know where we are on this, find out what they can do to be helpful on this, and also working on other county pieces where, since they can't take the lead here, they may be able to be a little more engaged in other aspects of the project.
So what's the timeline on this grant?
So I'll give it my best shot, and Kristen can correct me if I'm wrong. The application is due in August. After we submit the application, they do site visits in November. If we get called back or called for a site visit, obviously that's a good indication. We'll know December of this year, January of 2020, whether or not we are successful in getting the grant. And my understanding is the grant is for the amount we asked for, thumbs up, thumbs down, not some lesser amount. Is that correct? Right, so this is, go big or go home with at least this round of the process to get funding that's available in this cycle.
I'm so impressed with all the hard work you all have done on this, and the smarts to connect these things and to connect us with this grant is fantastic. Really excited about this project.
Great. Well, thanks. So we're looking forward to being back in 2 weeks with whatever we need from a conceptual standpoint to hopefully have that discussion and move forward. And as Kyle said, the Gilton City Council is committed.